إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. You know, as Muslims, we believe in several issues related to the Quran and the prophethood. And these issues include that Prophet Muhammad is the seal of the prophets, the Quran is the last divine message to mankind, the Quran is the only revelation that Allah subhanahu will take the responsibility of preserving it and protecting it from any corruption. And the Quran is valid for all times and all places. So we believe on these. And the reason why we believe on these, because we believe on it based on verses from the Quran. Allah subhanahu, for example, said for Surah Al-Ahzab, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَى أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Muhammad is not the father of any man among you, but he is the messenger of Allah and the seal of the prophets. Allah also says في سورة المائدة اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. This day I have perfected your religion for you and completed my blessing upon you and chosen for you Islam as a religion. Allah subhanahu also said في سورة الحج إنا نحن نزلنا الذكرى وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Indeed, we have revealed the reminder, which is the Quran, and we are surely its guardians. We are its protector. So we believe on these things that I mentioned because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this in the Quran. But for a non-Muslim, you know, he may challenge these claims by questions such as, why Allah stopped sending prophets while he used to send the prophets even to individual cities? You know, don't the people today still need some guidance? Why the Quran will be the last revelation, and why it is the only revelation that Allah granted to protect it? Why Allah didn't protect the previous revelations? How come the Quran that was revealed over 1400 years ago be suitable for all times and places? So this question, we can dismiss it as Muslim easily by saying Allah does whatever he wants. He chose the Quran to be the last message to mankind. He decided to preserve it himself from any corruption. He selected Prophet Muhammad to be his last prophet to mankind. And he decreed the Quran is the only revelation that he will use as basis for his judgment among the people in the day of judgment. And we will be justified to making this assessment because no one has the right to question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's decision. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us this. He said for Surah Al-Anbiya, لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. He is not questioned of what he does, but they are questions. So we cannot ask Allah. If Allah decided something, we cannot ask why, you know. So, but suddenly we addressing the question by still quoting verses from the Quran, which is a person who asking a question doesn't believe in it to start with. So we really need to come probably with some rational, you know, explanation for it. We can propose that humanity is like a child that was growing. At early ages, the child needs a lot of attention, and thus Allah has to send to him many prophets to guide him, and also at the early stages, this guidance needs to be simple. As a child matures, he will need less attention, and thus the number of prophets to guide him will be reduced. And we know that in some, in the past, for the same town, Allah subhanahu will send not one prophet, but will send three prophets. But now the child is mature enough, so Allah doesn't have to send as many prophets. And in the same time, the level of responsibilities upon that child will increase. At some point, the child will grow up and become sufficiently mature that he will receive a final comprehensive guidance that includes new commands, but basic principle that he can understand and advance based on these principles. And thus he no longer needs additional help. And this will be no more than when you go to school. And when you go to school, you progress from elementary school to middle school to high school to college to graduate school. Now, during all of these levels, we receive an instruction and take classes from teacher and professor. But after we reach the graduate school and receive the PhD degree, we will be considered sufficiently qualified to be on our own, to develop new knowledge, even in areas that we have not formally taken class in by a professor. So you can consider Islam as the PhD level of revelations. Christianity is maybe the master degree, Judaism maybe the bachelor degree, you know, and so on. So to address now the question, why the Quran is suitable for all times and places? So we generally, you know, say that the moral and the legal injunctions in the Quran are suitable for all times and places, are applicable for all times and places. And we may, but there, you know, we also may say that, you know, the Quran includes references to many scientific signs that are being proven accurate as our knowledge advances. But is this really all what is intended by having the Quran as the last divine revelation to mankind? Maybe there is something more subtle about the Quran that makes it so unique among all previous revelation to make it Allah's last message to mankind. When we examine previous revelations, we notice something, even including the Torah, which is the Torah is the most, you know, most comprehensive. We know that all these revelations, you know, was revealed at once and contains, and these revelations contained moral and legal rules, which is the Sharia for them. And thus, it is because it's only contained legal rules, it is logical that it will be revealed in totality at once. You know, you cannot reveal it piecemeal. But the Quran was revealed in 23 years. And Allah explains why the Quran was revealed in 23 years. Because this is something that the mushrikeen, the disbeliever, objected to, you know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Furqan, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدَةً. You know, those who disbelieve will say, why the Quran, you know, is not revealed to him all at once, like all of the others. So Allah subhanahu responded and said, كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا. Thus, it was revealed in parts that we may strengthen your heart therewith, and we have revealed it to you gradually at proper stages. So the Quran was revealed in parts corresponding to different occasion to strengthen the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believer. But now we have the Quran in its complete form with us. How would it strengthen our hearts based on verses related to events that happened during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So there must be something then far deeper in the Quran that makes it able to strengthen our heart as we read it. You know, to shed some light on this, I consider extremely important point, we need to reflect properly in the last lesson that Allah taught Prophet Musa. You know, we know through the life of Prophet Musa, the revelation to him was all of the physical nature that he and his followers saw. So we know the split of the sea, you know, he saw the split of the sea, the drowning of the Pharaoh and his army, the collapse of the mountain when Sayyidina, in front of Sayyidina Musa, the uprooting of the mountain over the, you know, people from who was basically worshipping the calf, and the split of the rocks in which, from which, you know, 12 springs were, you know, shown. And all of these are miracles that were observed by the eye. Only at one time that Prophet Musa faced with a physical event that has unseen purpose was during his encounter with the righteous man, which is Khidr. And so during this encounter, there appears to be two worlds. There is a visible world that Prophet Musa saw, and there is an invisible world or unseen world that was directing the events. This encounter is provided to us in Surah Al-Kahf, which is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has encouraged us and, you know, to read it every Friday. So there must be a purpose for this. And this encounter starts as follows. You know, when Sayyidina Musa came to the place when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directed him to say, when they went there, they said, فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا أَتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. When Sayyidina Musa reached that place, he and his servant, they found one of our servants whom we blessed with mercy from us, and we gave him knowledge from our own. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this person that Musa, the Prophet Musa have saw, is a person who is receiving knowledge from the unseen, from al-ghayb, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So qala lahu Musa, hal attabi'uka ala an tu'allimni mimma 'allamta rushdan. So Prophet Musa told him, may I follow you so that you can teach me some of the higher knowledge that you have taught. And this is, we said, knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly to that person. قال إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا وكيف تصبر على ما لم تحط به خبرة. So the Khidr or that man, he told the Sayyidina Musa, you will not be able to have patience with me. And how will you be patient over something that your comprehension cannot grasp? So Sayyidina Musa said, قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. You know, you will find me patient if Allah wills and shall not disobey any order from you. Then the Khidr or the man said, قال فإن اتبعتني فلا تسألني عن شيء حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرى. So if you follow me, then don't ask me about anything unless I myself start telling you about. Then we read, as we read for Surah Al-Kahf, about the three accounts of that the man did, which damaging the ship, killing the child, and fixing, you know, the damaged wound. Prophet Musa could not stand seeing this action by Khidr without objecting to it and asking for justification. And thus, he violated his promise not to ask. So after several warnings, Al-Khidr told Musa, هذا فراق بيني وبينك سأنبئك بتأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا. Now he told him, now this is the point of parting between me and you. You know, you haven't listened, you have been asking, objecting to my, you know, basically activities and asking questions which you promised you wouldn't ask. So I shall now tell you about the interpretation of those things about which you could not remain patient. So then Al-Khidr told the Prophet Musa the reasons behind all what he witnessed and ended the explanation by saying, وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. I did not do them on my own accord. That is the interpretation of those things that which you could not remain patient. So here we realize that there is two worlds. There is a visible world in which the events are seen by human eye, in this case by Sayyidina Musa. But there is another world that is invisible and it's directed by Allah and directs the events. So there appears to be a veil between these two worlds, and only Allah can expose this unseen world through the revelation. In the case of the Khidr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed him with basically exposed or removed that veil to the unseen to him to know some of this knowledge. Therefore, only, as I said, Al-Khidr explained to Prophet Musa what he did from the angle of the unseen world. Musa came to understand the insight behind the events that he saw, but could not understand their logic at the time of their happening. So now we can say the reason the Quran strengthened the heart of the Prophet ﷺ and his companions, because it exposed to them the events that they have encountered from the view of the unseen world, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly, which nobody knows. So if you look at this, the picture that I have in front of you, what is the objective of a prophet? The prophet's objective was to deliver to the seen world information from the unseen world, because he'd get the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have two actually worlds that exist. There is the unseen world, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls. Allah control also the seen world, but the knowledge in the unseen world, nobody knows it. We only know what we see in front, happening in front of us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah revealed to him some information that happened in the seen world, so he can deliver to the seen world. Now, in order for the prophets to stop, there must be something to deliver information from the unseen world to the seen world. And this is what I'm saying, proposing, that the Quran has in it all of the information related to all of the events that we will face in the visible world, and explain it to us what is happening in the seen world related to the same event. So the Quran in reality is the eternal message from Allah to reveal to us information from the unseen world regarding major events that we encounter and see in our life. Therefore, you don't need a prophet. That's it. The Quran is the one in front of you. Now, how can we derive this idea, that there is actually the Quran service as deliver to us the information of the unseen world to anything that will happen to us, that we see, and therefore we don't need a prophet to explain to us or give us, background about the events. We can look to the first revelations, the first few verses that were revealed to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We all know that these, with the beginning of the revelation, was the first few verses from Surah Al-Alaq. And this is why I put it in the beginning, you listen to it. And it started with, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. I made in red, little bit so you can focus on. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this five verses has two commands actually. One command, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala read, the first command is read. read in the name of your Lord who has created everything that exists, created man from a clean cloth. Then this is a command of read in the name of your Lord. There is another command, read, and your Lord is the most gracious, who has taught, you know, by the pen, or he imparted knowledge by the pen, teaches man that which he did not know. So while all of the knowledge, we know that all of the knowledge come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but these, you know, five verses of revelation, that is beginning of the revelation of the Quran, include actually two reading commands. The first reading command is reading in the name of the creator of all things. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. The other reading command is reading based on the blessing from Allah, who taught people how to make the pen and how to write with the pen. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. So I'm proposing here to you that this verse, we are not talking about the same reading. There is two reading. One reading, بإسم ربك الذي خلق, and the other reading, اقرأ ورب, reading by the blessing of Allah who taught by the pen. So what is the first reading and what is the second reading? So the two reading now, the first reading, I would say refer to the reading to develop knowledge through the ongoing revelation in the Quran to understand the behind the scene action in the unseen world. And this is controlled by Allah and are influencing what we see in this world. So when we do the first reading, بِإِسْمِ رَبِّكَ, you actually reading from the unseen world, from, you know, عَلَمُ الْغَيْبِ. You know, and this is the revelation that Allah, the prophets, used to deliver, you know, from alam al-ghayb. No, the Quran, now you read in the Quran this, you know, revelation from the alam al-ghayb. Now, the second reading, which is now, the, you know, and you know, the second reading will be the reading that will happen through, basically happen in the visible world. And this is the reading on the basis that required to advance the human race. And this is by developing a cumulative knowledge through transformation of knowledge from one generation to the other, how we are going to transfer knowledge from one generation to the other, except by writing, by the pen. So in this reading are required for the advancement of the human race. And this can be done, reading by the, learning by the pen, this can be done by the believer or non-believers, because this is a knowledge that will require to basically advance humanity. But now the believer will read with considering ورَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ, with the blessing of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. While the non-believer just read, you know, read and learn more knowledge. So both reading of a believer and reading of a non-believer, both will develop or deliver cumulative knowledge and will cause advancement in our life. But when reading lead to reinforcement of belief of the believer, while the other reading will not. So you find out, you know, a believer who develops science, who look at science or natural science study it, that will reinforce his belief in God. The other person who does the same thing, but he even become an atheist. The difference between the two is one reading considering ورَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ and the other reading without ورَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ. So what I'm saying now, so there is, if you look in the Quran, there is two reading. There is reading of the al-ghayb, unseen, and there is reading that Allah commands or refers to, which you have to learn on your own by the pen. So these two elements does exist in the Quran. So when we look at this, we see that now as time develops, our understanding the Quran will give us more information as the time. You know, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, if you look at the circle in the middle of the circle, the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there was, they understood from the Quran, you know, the unseen, information from the unseen. As the time moves on, there is more information in the Quran that probably the time the companion, and at that time they didn't understand, they didn't relate to. So now, however, in order for us, because our knowledge, our life become complicated, the Quran must continue to provide for us something from, as in the unseen world, from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, you know. So, but now, in order, how are we going to find it out? How are we going to come and derive this information from the Quran to explain to us what is happening in front of us, but from the angle of the unseen world? What is the, what exists, what the Allah subhanahu intended for what we happening, and do really understand what we see is really the reality or not? Now, Allah subhanahu in order tell us that in order for to reveal to us this information, then we must possess two attributes. There is two, you know, prerequisite. If you are going to come today and say, well, okay, how can I see, can I derive from the Quran information from this unseen world? I said, you have to have two attributes. One of them, that you have to be committed to have taqwa, so Allah can open for you the gates of knowledge by Him. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Have taqwa of Allah and Allah will teach you. So you will see what other people don't see in the Quran. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ended the verse by saying, and Allah is all-knowing, knowing of all things. That Allah knows everything, knows the seen and the unseen. Then another prerequisite, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you are going to do this, you better be serious in studying the Quran and do the proper tadabbur of it. Don't, it's not just superficial reading, just for blessing. No, you are going to be serious about your study of the Quran and the analysis of it. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Sad, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِي وَلِيَتَذَكَّرُوا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. This is the book we have sent to you as full of blessing. That's a full of information that make you, that will satisfy you. But that only for those who tadabbur of these verses and those who have understanding may actually heed and reflect on the commands. So let us look at one example in the Quran, how interaction, the Quran provide us an interaction between the visible world, the seen world, and the unseen world for one event. And this is related to the Battle of Badr. But before I discuss this, you know, present that seen and unseen world, looking at the same event, you know, I really want to make a strong statement here so nobody can be confused about it, you know. First of all, that I am not talking about some of those people who claim that they, and claim it for deceiving other people, they claim we have access to hidden and secret knowledge in the Quran. No, there is no hidden and secret knowledge in the Quran. The Quran is open book for all people who have taqwa and are serious in studying it and doing the proper analysis of its verses to deduce what is happening around them and what will happen after. You know, so it is not, I'm not talking about some of these, you know, people who claim they have secrets. There's no secrets, you know, in the Quran. So I'm not talking about secrets. I'm talking about things that, you know, that you can derive, I can derive, if we have the right taqwa and we can really do our serious study on it. So let me look at the example of Surah Badr. And if you ask any companion, what did he see from Surah Badr? What happened to this? Then we'll see the companion will tell you, well, we were going to attack the caravan, which is led by Abu Sufyan. At certain location, we discovered that Abu Sufyan had changed direction and he was able to evade us. Then the news came to us that the leader of Quraysh assembled, you know, a large army to come to fight us, and they come in to attack us. So while, you know, our numbers, you know, was small, we couldn't go back because we have no choice but to face, you know, the army from Quraysh. Then the two, we met them at a specific location, which is the location of Badr. Then we noticed that a light rain came to us, and so it became our land, you know, firm. And then it cooled actually the air that we slept a little bit even before the day of the battle. And when we looked, when we wake up in the morning and looked at the army of Quraysh, we find them just a very small number. And this eased our concern. And then the fight started and ended by us winning the war, winning the battle from them. So that is, if you ask any Muslim at that time, what did he saw? He will tell you this is the events that happened. If you ask now from Quraysh, what happened? You know, they will tell you that we heard the news that the Muslim planned to attack the caravan led by Abu Sufyan. So we assembled an army and marched to fight them to protect the caravan. But while we were in a way, the news came to us that Abu Sufyan was safe and he was able to evade the Muslim. So we were considering returning back to Mecca. So there's no reason for us to go fight them. But suddenly a man came to us and looked like a wise man and strong man and kept persuading us, our leaders, to continue to fight the Muslim to finish them because they could not have been prepared since they were only planning to attack the caravan. Now, he kept encouraging us and promised that he will fight with us. You know, our leader, you were convinced and decided, let us continue the fight, you know, for fight the Muslims. And the man led us to a location where the Muslims were there. Then when we arrived, we looked at the Muslim army and we saw them very small in number. And this made us very confident that we can easily wipe them all. Then the battle started, and it was started not going our way. You know, we find out there is some major restraint on us. We cannot think right. We cannot even lift our hand right, you know, to fight. So we looked at this man who was with us, you know, who promised us, he came with us and promised to join us. We no longer find him. And we don't know where he gone. And the battle ended with us losing the battle. So if you, this will be the view from the seen world. And this is the scenes that Muslims and the people from Quraysh have saw regarding the battles. Now, but after the battle of Badr now, Allah revealed to the Muslims in Surah Al-Anfal the views of the battle now from the unseen world. It wasn't what they have seen, you know. And first, the place where the battle happened was not accidental. Muslim did not stumble on this location. You know, it was a planned location by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, and if the Muslims, actually, if the Muslim and the people of Quraysh would agree to a location, they would have missed that location and they had to come to this location, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have decreed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Anfal, verse 42, وَإِذْ أَنْتُمْ بِالْعُدْوَةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ بِالْعُدْوَةِ الْقُصْوَى وَالرَّكْبُ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَوْ تَوَاعَدْتُمْ لَاخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِي الْمِعَادِ وَلَكِنْ لِيَقْضِيَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا كَانَ مَفْعُولًا لِيَهْلِكَ مَنْ هَلَكَ عَنْ بَيِّنَةٍ وَيَحْيَى مَنْ حَيَا عَنْ بَيِّنَةٍ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَسَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, remember this. When you, the Muslim army, were in the near side of the valley, and they, the farther side, which is the Quraysh army, and the caravan was downward from you, it's already gone. Even if you had a mutual appointment to meet, you would have certainly failed in this appointment. But you met at that specific location, so Allah might accomplish what was already distance to be done, so that those who were to perish may perish knowingly, and whoever is going to live may live by clear evidence, and surely Allah, all hearer and all knower. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, you think that this place that you met was accidental, it just happened? No, It was already a pre-planned from me. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what do you think that when you looked at them and saw their number small, and they looked at you and saw your number small, you know, to encourage you to fight each other, was this also unplanned? It was planned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذْ يُرِيكُمُهُمْ إِذَا الْتَقَيْتُمْ فِي يُرِيكُهُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ قَلِيلًا وَيُقَلِّلُكُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ لِيَقْضِيَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا كَانَ مَفْعُولًا وَإِلَى اللَّهِ تُرْجَعُ الْأُمُورُ. And at the time when you met each other, Allah showed them to you few in numbers in your eyes, and reduced their number, your number in their eyes, so that Allah might accomplish what was destined to be done. And Allah, all matters return, and to Allah all matters return to Him. So now, how about the light rain? Would the light rain just came to, so you can, it came also, Allah moved the, you know, or the was a blessing that the rain came to you so it can reinforce, you know, the soil and make the soil firm under your feet? No. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the rain came to you to achieve four things, not one thing, that other things that you are not aware of. The rain came to purify you, came to remove the insinuation of Satan from your mind or from your heart. It came to strengthen your heart, and it came to stabilize your feet, which you already have recognized because this is a visible thing. And so Allah subhanahu also said for Surah Al-Anfal, إِذْ يُغَشِّكُمْ النُّعَاسَ أَمَنَةً مِنْهِ وَيُنَزِّلْ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِّرَكُمْ بِهِ وَيُذْهِبْ عَنْكُمْ لِيُطَهِّرَكُمْ بِهِ وَيُذْهِبْ عَنْكُمْ رِجْسَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَلِيَرْبِطْ عَلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتَ بِهِ الْأَقْدَامَ. When he covered you with a drowness, tranquility descending from him, and send down upon you water from the heavens, so that he might purify you with it, remove from you the impurity of Satan, strengthen your hearts, and make your feet firm therewith. So another scene, I don't know if anybody, somebody need to mute himself. Another scene from the invisible world that neither the Muslim nor the people from Quraysh saw was the interference of the angel to put fear in the heart of Quraysh army and to confuse their brain and weaken their hands. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُوحِي رَبُّكَ إِلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي مَعْكُمْ فَثَبِّتُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا سَأُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ فَاضْرِبُوا فَوْقَ الْأَعْنَاقِ وَاضْرِبُوا فَوْقَ مِنْهُمْ كُلَّ بَنَانٍ. When your Lord revealed to the angel, I am with you, so make firm the feet of those who believe, I shall cast a fear in the heart of those who disbelieve, so strike at the necks and strike at every finger point of theirs. So that is not all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also from the unseen world, it exposes to us who is this man that came to Quraysh and encouraged them to fight and promised to join them, and then why he abandoned them when the battle started. Allah subhanahu tells us, وَإِذْ زَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَقَالَ لَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ الْيَوْمَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَإِنِّي جَارٌ لَكُمْ. And when Satan, no, it wasn't an rural man, it was a Satan. Satan came in a form of a man, made their deeds look beautiful to them, and said to them, none of the people can overcome you today. You know, and I am a protector of you, I'm going to fight with you. فَلَمَّ تَرَاءَتِ الْفِئَتَانِ نَكَصَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ وَقَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْكُمْ إِنِّي أَرَى مَا لَا تَرَوْنَ وَإِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. But now when he saw the two groups faced each other, he turned back on his heels and he ran away and said, I have nothing to do with you. I am seeing what you do not see. I am scared of Allah, and Allah is severe in punishment. Now, this is just one example of how you show the uniqueness of the Quran, that exposing an events from the sight of the unseen world. Some of these events happened during the life of the Prophet ﷺ, but the Quran was not only revealed for this time. Quran was revealed for all time, from the time of till the end. There are many others, you know, that actually Al-Quran revealed that happened during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, happened before the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and will happen after the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know. Now, but some may still, you know, continue ask, the question and say, okay, now, but with the end of the revelation by the death of the Prophet, does the insight understanding of the events end that we have? And obviously the answer is no, because that's what I have been arguing for. I said, no, the Quran includes all that we need to know and understand of what will be, what is happening during the time of the Prophet, and what is happening now, and what will happen in the future, you know. But to understand the revelation, the, you know, of the events that we see, you know, from the unseen world, or understand the events that we see from the unseen world, we must have taqwa and read the Quran with serious adab. Now, and we have, and another point that you have to keep clear, that all of the, you know, the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't reveal to us all of the stories of all the prophets and all of the events that happened in the past. But the events that happened in the past, Allah then give it to us with some of the background on what's going to happen as an outcome of these events, because they will be repeated during our time, or during the time after, from now until the end of time. Now, we can look, actually, maybe give you just, you know, a couple of examples to highlight this issue. All what I'm asking you to go and read Surah Al-Buruj, verses 4 to 10, and know about the people of the ditch, what's happened to them. And study this event and compare it with what happened to the Rohingyas. And when you look at the event, you said, what is expected to happen as an outcome to what happened to them, and what is the outcome that's going to happen to the as a result of the Rohingya, for all those people who did it, who supported it, who looked at it that could have stopped it and didn't, and then those people who just watched it and did nothing. What is going to happen to them? Now you can read what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say is going to happen to all of those people from these verses. And now you can actually explain some of the events that we'll probably see happening in front of us now. Now, another one, you can look to some of physical events. Like we all look at the rain, and we know sometimes you get droughts, and you look, you know, you get sometimes flooding and hurricanes and so on. Well, you can look at this from two angles. You can look at it from the seen world, and you look at it from the unseen world, as the Quran Allah revealed to us what is really happening here. So from the seen world, we can say, okay, we understand the water cycle and the movement of the wind and the dry, you know, and we use it to forecast, you know, weather, climate, and water resources. But we also found out that something is very interesting, that the amount of water that falls on Earth every year is almost the same, doesn't change. What it changes is the distribution of it, where it goes. And from the information you find, every year there is 500,000 cubic kilometers of rain falls on Earth, which if get distributed uniformly over the Earth, then every place will get like 39 inches of rain per year. But obviously it doesn't get distributed uniformly. And all what, you know, our science is trying to tell us how it moves, how the water, how the clouds move, where does it go, the direction it goes, why in some places it moves away and rain doesn't come for a year and then we get suffered drought. And in some other places, you know, you're getting hurricanes and get flooding and heavy rain and so on. So we try to study to understand these things from, you know, the seen world, the physics, the natural sciences, the analysis that we do from the observation we do. But if we look at the same phenomena from the unseen world, from the revelation, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Then we look from, you know, for Surah Al-A'raf and for Surah Al-Rum and other verses talk about the rain, the movement of the wind, the clouds and so on, and what happened to them and who directed them to where they are. So you can be a scientist, you know, study, you know, hydrology or study water cycle and so on, and you could be a believer, and that the two look at it differently, although they look at it from a scientific point of view the same. One look at it from that it is just the natural phenomena, and the other look at it, no, Allah subhanahu interferes, and these things are pre-planned. Even the movement of the wind, how the air moves, how the water comes, where it is drops, and so on, that is always something that, you know, that you really have, a Muslim have to look at it and understand it from the two angles. So, but the important point, frankly, for Muslim, that they have to read, as Allah subhanahu commands us, from the two angles. We have to read from the seen world view, and we have to read what is happening from the unseen world view, if we are going to become the leader of the world and fulfill the, you know, the mission that Allah have made us as Khulafa fil Ard, as His vicegerent on earth. So we pray to Allah subhanahu to increase our taqwa and bless us with the wisdom of tadabbur, to have the insight on the events that are happening around us now and learn how to react to them and prepare for their expected development. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت. اللهم بارك لنا فيما أعطيت. اللهم قنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت، إنك ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. اللهم أوزعنا أن نشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علينا وعلى والدينا وأن نعمل صالحا ترضاه. اللهم اصلح لنا في ذريتنا، إنا تبنا إليك وإننا من المسلمين. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك، وبطاعتك عن معصيتك، وفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك على كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us. Shower us with your blessings. Increase our knowledge. Grant us forgiveness. And reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaws al-A'la. Oh Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. Oh Allah, forgive our parents and grant them your mercy, and make their graves a garden from heaven, and grant them the Firdaws al-A'la. Oh Allah, we have friends and relatives who have passed away. Oh Allah, forgive them, have mercy upon them. Oh Allah, pardon them, and make honorable the reception. Surely you are the oft forgiven, most merciful. O Allah, remedy our sick and grant them full and speed recovery. O Allah, grant our son Maraj and all our sick relatives and friends speedy and full recovery. O Allah, you alone is the ultimate curer. There is no cures but yours. O Allah, grant them a cure that leaves nothing of injury and ailment. O Allah, grant us the ability to be grateful for your favor that you have bestowed upon us and upon our parents, and that we may do righteous deeds that are pleasing to you. O Allah, guide our children, protect them, and make them righteous. O Allah, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't, and we seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. O Allah, we ask with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weakness have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. O Allah, you said this, du'uni astajib lakum, ask me and I respond to you. O Allah, we are asking you as you have commanded us. O Allah, accept our dua. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amalu salihat. وتواصل بالحق وتواصل بالصبر. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.